Together, pilots, controllers, and flight attendants have delivered the safest mode of transportation worldwide. It takes impeccable communication and collaboration, which extends your crew beyond those sitting in the cockpit.
Controllers have to understand what that workload looks like in the cockpit. Likewise, pilots need to have awareness of what's going on in the airspace around them and the whole scope of things that controllers are needing to deal with. There's nothing that substitutes for really putting yourself in another person's shoes, or in this case, another person's seat, and really understanding what's going on in their work environment.
In collaboration with the FAA and the National Air Traffic Controllers Association, the Airline Pilots Association captured this social experiment for both pilots and controllers to learn more about their role in safely moving aircraft through the national airspace system. With NATCA's help, we took Delta First Officer Tim Heipel on a tour of the tower at Atlanta's International Airport. This was his first visit to an air traffic control facility in his 19 years of professional flying. He gained a better understanding of the controller's workload and responsibilities, along with a new appreciation for what they do.
Everybody in that tower is capable of working in a different position, and I was always under the impression that each controller, you know, you were a tower controller and that's all you did, or you're a ground controller and that's all you did. But I found out in the Atlanta tower, you need to be able to work every position, and they rotate through.
Representatives of NATCA explained the controller's daily operations at the tower, TRACON, and center.
Working at the TRACON is different from the tower because we are a pure radar environment. We're different from the center because their primary function is en route. They transition aircraft at high altitude from point A to point B. We work between the tower and the center to facilitate departures transitioning from the airport to the en route environment, and then we take the aircraft from the en route environment and get them all lined up and in sequence to land at the airport.
For the full experience, though, a controller needed to sit in the left seat of an airliner. So ALPA arranged for NATCA rep Brian Volante to fly a 757. Simulator, that is.
This is the first time I've ever been in a simulator like this, the ones that the airline pilots actually use. It was a real eye-opener for how much is going on in the cockpit, how much noise is in the cockpit, their checklist, and their workload. For me to give them information in a timely manner, it's a lot of information at one time.
Sitting in each other's seat, it's easy to see why the pilot-controller relationship is vitally important to aviation safety. That's why ALPA and NATCA work together to encourage the FAA to reinstate the flight deck training program, also known as FAM flights.
One of the things that I heard from controllers from the very day I came to the FAA was the value of this program is that it enables a controller to actually see how the National Airspace System operates from the pilot's perspective, how they have to factor in managing a very complex machine at the same time they're interacting with the controllers.
The agency reopened the jump seat to controllers in May of last year, addressing the security concerns that froze the program after the 9/11 attacks.
It is great to be back in the cockpit again, because you get a little feel what it's like to be delayed. You get a little feel about what it's like to not have somebody respond to you right away. It's important, especially for our younger people, to get into these cockpits so they can see things from somebody else's perspective.
Nate Pear, the NATCA rep for Los Angeles Center, falls into that category. He brings 13 years of experience to the job and rode jump seat for the first time last year on a flight from LA to Dulles.
Some of the more important things I was able to see was when we're issuing turns, when we're issuing speeds, and we're issuing altitude changes, we just say the words, turn this heading, descend to this altitude, maintain this speed. So to see the pilot and the co-pilot working in conjunction with each other and putting those things in and maintaining and watching and the amount of work that goes into it, it really was a vital thing for me even to bring back to the controller workforce and to my union brothers and sisters to explain to them the things that they're doing.
Getting pilots to tour air traffic control facilities is equally important for truly understanding how the collaboration extends beyond the cockpit.
I have talked with pilots about what goes on in facilities, and my sense is they find it extremely helpful to understand the different functions that take place in a TRACON, in a center, or at a tower. They walk away with a much better understanding of how the whole system works, and I think a greater appreciation for the guy or the woman that's on the other end of the microphone.
I encourage anybody that has any interest at all to come over here and do a tour. It's open. And also to let the controllers know that now that we have the observation capability with the jump seats, that the controllers are more than welcome to come and ride the jump seat to kind of see it from our perspective as pilots.